Hello learners, this is another session and we are going to deal another topic. The topic of this session is, what is listening? There are two essential parts to any communication. One would be listening, another would be speaking. And in this session, we are going to delve into detail about what is listening. If technically speaking, listening is a process of receiving, constructing meaning from whatever we have listened and responding to spoken and or non-verbal messages to hear something with thoughtful attention. So if you deliver into the message, we understand that it's careful listening. It's not just a physical process, it's a process which includes some physical part and there is a mental part involved in it. Listening is a dynamic and a transactional process, which is a process of receiving, recalling, rating and responding to stimuli. There could be various stimuli in the setting. There would be some verbal stimuli, there would be some non-verbal stimuli. And listening needs to respond to both of them. Before moving further, let's just understand that what is the basic difference between these two words, hearing and listening. These two words, hearing and listening, have often been synonymously used. However, if you get into the depth, you would realize that they both are meaning something different. Hearing, on one hand, is typically a physical process. It doesn't include any mental aspect to it. However, when we turn to listening, listening is both a physical and a mental process. So that's the basic and the premise difference between hearing and listening. Again, hearing is something which is a learned, which is not a learned activity. This is a natural process. However, listening is something which is a learned process. In due conversation of life, we learn how to listen. It's not that we are born with this ability to listen. So it's a learned process. And whereas listening is a natural process. Similarly, hearing is a passive process and listening is an active process. Following from what we had discussed earlier, as we said that listening is a learned process, so it becomes an active process because there is an element of mental element which is involved in the same. Here the individual himself is involved in the process. However, if you look at hearing, since it's a natural process and it's just a physical process, even if you do not want your hearing, so you are passive in that process. Now, as a teacher, one needs to understand between these two processes of hearing and listening. Why? Because you need to tell your students, you need to teach your students that we shouldn't be doing just hearing in the classroom. They need to be involved in the process and they need to listen actively. So they should be listening rather than hearing. Moving further, let's understand what are the different stages of listening. Number one, the number one stage of listening would be receiving. Receiving is that stage wherein you're physically hearing a message and taking a note of it. The note may be a verbal note, the note may be a written note, or the note may be a mental note. So you may be using your notebook for the same, you may be using your mind for the same. Further, within this process, you are affected by external factors, that is noise. Noise becomes very essential here to be eliminated. Essential, why? Because the teacher needs to take care that the noise should be eliminated. If the noise is there in the classroom, this process, the first stage of the listening process is going to be duly affected by it. The second stage is interpreting. What is interpreting? This is inferring the speaker's meaning based on your own experiences. Now, we all have our own experiences because we all are born individuals and we all are active people. So, we have constructed our experiences based on whatever we have gone through life. Now, interpreting would be inferring the speaker's meaning based on the individual's own experiences. There is a need to understand the speaker's frame of reference here. So that's why we call listening to be a skill, because here you see that during the interpretation process, the receiver needs to understand the speaker's frame of reference. This can be done only if the speaker is passive in terms of he's just delivering the message, and the listener, he has to be or she has to be active in that process. Moving further, the third stage is remembering. Now, what happens during this stage is, one is storing the message for the future reference. It doesn't happen that listening stops here only. You are not just receiving the information and interpreting out of it. You are storing it also. You are remembering it also. Why? Because you may need the same message for the future reference. So the teacher, while delivering in the classroom, needs to understand that she is making positions for the same, that the student is not just able to receive, interpret, but the student is also able to remember the same things. Moving further, the fourth stage, evaluating, here what happens in the evaluating stage is that the listener considers the points mentioned and assesses their importance. So now here comes the mental part of it, the mental element of the process of listening, wherein the listener is considering the different points which have been mentioned in the communication by the speaker, and then he is considering and then assessing their importance. Assessing in the sense to understand what is important for the individual and what is not important for the individual. Now, when we are listening to a conversation, there would be some elements which we want to remember and there would be others which we just want to forget about it. So, evaluation is that process wherein the listener is considering the points mentioned and he or she is assessing the importance. Herein, again, the role of the teacher plays a major part here, because it's the teacher who is going to train the listener, or at least speak about those things to the listener so that they understand that what parts are to be kept and how they have to be assessed also. Moving further, the next stage of the process of listening is responding. What is responding? Responding is reacting to the speaker's message. We just cannot do with evaluation stage. We need to respond to the speaker's message also. Why? Because communication is a two-way process. It's not a one-way process. It's not that only the speaker is going to speak and the listener is going to listen. Listener is also going to become the speaker, and the speaker would then turn to be a listener. So, responding is an essential part of the communication process or the listening process in particular. The last stage of the process would be acting. Now, there won't be all conversations or all instructions or all listening capabilities which would lead to acting, but on certain occasions, action becomes vital. So now we are clear with the six stages of listening. What are they? They are receiving, interpreting, remembering, evaluating, responding, and acting. Let's move further. Now, how do you make sense of conversation? When we are listening, we have gone through the six stages of listening, but we need to understand that how do you make sense of a particular conversation? Now, there are two ways for the same. In the first way, the process goes like the listener is going to understand the dialogue based on the words of the speaker. So, the speaker, when is delivering a message, he or she would have used certain kinds of words in a certain format. So, in this way, in this first way in which the listener is making sense of the conversation which has gone through, the listener would understand the dialogue based on the words which have been used by the speaker. Now, since the understanding is based on the use of words, it becomes essential that there is a decoding of words which goes through. Not just words, there should be a decoding of clauses, sentences, or any other kind of text material which has been used by the speaker during the conversation process. So, first there is going to be hearing of the words, then you are making an understanding of the different words which have been used. The third stage or the third step of the same would be the listener needs to be aware of the meaning of the words and the arrangement or the pattern in which they would appear in the sentence. Now, what I'm trying to say by the same is that the listener should have some basic understanding of the language which has been used by the speaker. Only if you have an understanding of the basic language, only if you have an understanding of how the words have been arranged in a particular sentence or how the words are arranged in a particular sentence in a particular language, only then you will be able to make sense out of the same. Where does the, if you take the example of English, where does noun lies, where does pronoun lies, where does adjectives lies, and where does the verb lies? I'm just taking example of the four forms of the sentence: noun, adjective, verb, or any other part of the speech. So, if you are accustomed to the same, if you know how, if you have a know-how of the same, that how these are to be used, where do they occur, what is the pattern of their usage in the sentence, only then the listener would be able to make sense out of it. Now, once we say that, we understand that how important a language is for understanding, how important the grammar is for understanding the things. That's why we say that language is the most essential part of communication or most essential part of curriculum also, because it's going to lay the base of your understanding, or it's going to lay the base of the listener's understanding in all the subjects. So, if a student is having a reasonable grammar, if a student is having a fair understanding of the parts of the speech, the child or the learner is able to perform better, not just in the language, but also in the other subjects. Coming back, let's see if we see the first way of the conversation, what this way helps in acquiring. This way helps in acquiring the following skills, which I'm going to list down. Number one, to listen to a sentence carefully, to recognize the keywords, to understand the grammatical relationship between the keywords and the sentences. Also, to understand the relevance of any stress and pause that the speaker uses, for example, to identify a keyword. Now, just understand the four things which I talked about. The number one is listening to a sentence carefully. Now, that's the basic premise of any kind of conversation and any way of understanding things. Second is recognizing the key words. So, within the sentence which has been used by the speaker, the listener needs to see that what are the keywords. If the listener is able to identify those keywords, the listener would be able to understand the meaning in a better manner. Not just the keywords, even the listener needs to understand the grammatical relationship which is existing between the keywords and the sentences. Also, the listener needs to understand the relevance of any stress and pause which has been used by the speaker. Now, if a conversation is happening, there is a lot of stimulus variation which is there in the speaker's communication. This essentially comes across if the speaker is a good communicator, because only then he would be using certain kinds of intonation, pauses, stresses, and if the listener is able to identify these things properly, the listener will be able to identify the keywords also properly. So, if the listener is going through these things, these are the skills which the listener is going to understand or which the listener is going to acquire during the process of conversation. This was one way of conversation. Now, the second way in which we can make the sense of conversation is, number one, let's see how this process goes. It goes by, we understand the sentence which is based on our previous knowledge. Now, this is very different from the conversation which was happening in the first process, where we were making sense of the words which were coming through. Here in this process, we are understanding the sentences based on our previous knowledge of the topic which has been talked about. Here the previous knowledge is more important, and in the previous conversation style or the previous understanding style of the conversation, the words were more important. The second step here would be, while the process of understanding meaning based on the words takes us from words to meaning, the process of understanding meaning based on previous knowledge takes us from meaning to words. So, what was happening in the first way of understanding the conversation or making sense of the conversation was that we were moving from word to meaning. But what is happening in the second style of conversation understanding is that we are moving from meaning based on previous knowledge to the words. So, they are working in different direction. That was word to meaning, and the second way is meaning to words. I'm not trying to say in any ways that which conversation understanding style would be better. Both have their own role, but we need to understand that what is the difference between the two. Moving further, in the second way of conversation, we need previous knowledge, which may be based on some kind of conversations, some kind of reading which the listener is doing, and some kind of conversations, experiences which the listener had over the during period of his lifetime. So, it's not just the words which are making sense here, it's the previous knowledge which is helping the listener understand what the speaker is talking about. And where this previous knowledge is based on, it's based on the conversation, it may be based on the experiences of the learner or the listener, or it may be based on the reading which the listener is doing. So, again here a catch point comes in, reading makes a difference. if the listener is exposed to different kind of reading material, or if the listener does different kind of reading, the listener would be in a better position to make sense of the conversation. So it adds to the skill of the learner or the listener. Now, how does this way helps? This way helps in acquiring certain skills, as was the first way. What are the different skills which what one acquires when one is going through this process of conversation or this process of understanding of conversation? The number one skill would be to make sense of the conversation based on the keywords. So what's happening here is, since we are going to waste our knowledge based on the previous knowledge, we are going to understand our listening based on the previous knowledge, we are going to make sense of the conversation based on the previous knowledge. So what you are going to pick from the conversation is, or what the listener is going to pick from the conversation is the keywords. So during this style of understanding from the process of conversation, the listener would be developing his skills wherein he would be understanding the conversation based on keywords. Then the second skill which the listener acquires here is, it raises the questions about the situation. Now, once you are learning from the conversation based on the previous knowledge, it cannot be a passive process. Though listening is never a passive process, but in this style of understanding or this style of making sense from the conversation, raising questions becomes more important. It becomes essential for the listener that he or she raises questions about the situation, about the experiences which the speaker is talking about the discourse material which the speaker is talking about. So if you raise the questions, then you are going to understand this process, or you are going to be able to make sense of this conversation in a better manner. The third skill which the listener gains in this understanding style is, it is estimating the cause and effect relationship. There is always a cause to the aspect and there is always an effect to the same. In this style of making sense of the conversation, the listener is acquiring the skill wherein the listener is able to estimate this relationship between the cause and effect. That what kind of cause is going to produce what kind of effect. How much the magnitude of the cause can produce how much magnitude of the effect. So that's the basic premise about the second style of conversation. Another skill which the listener gains here in this process of conversation is estimating the unsaid details of a situation. Now, when the listener is understanding from a conversation, it's not always that the speaker would be sharing all the details. There would be things which the speaker would be sharing, and there would be things which the listener is left to understand. The listener is left to imagine. The listener is left to estimate. So in this style of conversation understanding, the listener is better left with those kind of skills wherein he is or she is able to estimate the unsaid details of a situation. Now, we have understood that there are basically two ways in which we make sense of a conversation. One is moving from words to meanings, and the other one is moving from opposite direction. They are moving from meaning to words. One is based more on your understanding or the listener's understanding of the grammatical aspects of the language and the arrangement of the words, the pattern in which the words exist. And the second one is based on the previous knowledge of the listener. So whatever previous knowledge the listener has, the sense is made of the conversation is based on the previous knowledge which the listener has. Now, but what do you think? Does it happen that only one of these styles would predominate? No, it doesn't happen that way. There is always a culmination of both these processes. You cannot do that you are using only one way of making sense of the conversation. You would have to use both the ways. Both these ways or both these processes run in parallel while you are listening to a conversation. They are not in opposite directions. They may be having different characteristics, but they are running parallel when you are listening to a conversation. The responsibility of deciding the extent to which each process will be used will depend upon the listener. So since the two processes are going simultaneously, meanings to words and words to meaning, both these processes are supposed to be run parallel to each other. But still, the listener needs to have the skill, or the teacher needs to equip the listener with this kind of skill that the listener is able to decipher and decide that which process I'm going to use in which situations, which process will be more emphasized in which kind of situations. Now, it depends on certain factors that listener will be using which of these processes more during the style of conversation. Now, what are these factors on which this would depend? This would depend on whether the listener is familiar with what is being talked about. If the listener is familiar with what is being talked about, probably the second way of conversation is going to work better, because there you are going to make sense based on your previous knowledge. But if the listener is not familiar about what is being talked about, if you are listening to a topic which is entirely new, which you have never heard about, probably the first style of conversation in which we are understanding, making sense of the conversation based on the meaning of the words, that would work better. Secondly, another factor which is going to determine that which way or which process the listener should be using to understand the conversation is also depending on how much the listener or the learner is familiar with the depth of the information. Now, if there is a topic which you have already read about, if there is a topic which the listener or the child or the learner has already read about and he or she is familiar with the same, so the child or the listener would know the depth of the information about the same. Now, that would determine the style of conversation process which we are going to follow, whether we are going to move from words to meanings or whether we are going to move from meanings to words. If you have the depth information, you are going to move from meaning to words. But if you do not have that depth, if the listener doesn't have that familiarity with the subject, then he is going to move from words to meanings. So, the arrangement, the pattern, the different forms of the speech would become more important in this case. Moving further, the listener should be familiar with the type of information which is being given. This also determines the which process as a listener I would be using, the kind of information which is being given. If it's a theoretical kind of thing, if it's just an informative kind of thing, if there is a general knowledge questions kind of thing, probably the listener should move from meanings to words to meanings. But if it's an understanding kind of thing, wherein you are understanding a confirmation, understanding a concept, then you are going to move from meaning to words. Another factor which determines the same is the listener's purpose of listening. Now, that's the most important aspect if we understand this whole process of conversation, or if we understand this whole process of communication. It's the listener's purpose of listening which becomes the most important element, because it's going to be the thing which is going to determine that how much involvement the listener is going to have in the process. If the listener's purpose is to really listen, if the listener's purpose is to really understand the things, then he or she is going to use the two processes parallelly, and he'll be able to decide better that which aspect of the conversation style has to be adopted, whether it should be moving from words to meaning or whether it should be moving from meaning to words. But if the listener is just listening for the sake of listening, then the whole conversation style takes a different style or takes a different approach. Because if you're just listening for the sake of listening, then you do not have that intent, or the listener doesn't have that kind of intent to really listen in the terms. So the approach would be different. Now, herein comes the role of the teacher. The teacher really plays an essential role, because the teacher needs to develop the listening skill among the students. It's an essential part of any communication, whether the communication is happening in the formal settings like classrooms, or whether the communication is happening in informal settings like probably a marketplace or probably a mall or any other kind of setting, railway station or any kind of setting wherein this process is happening. Because communication is not limited only to the formal classrooms. Communication is not limited only to the formal settings. Communication is across life. It's dominating your formal aspects also, and it's dominating the informal aspects of your life also. So the teacher's role becomes important, because she needs to equip her students or his students with the skill of listening. You cannot say that listening is a process which ahi jayegi, the students will learn on their own. It's not something like that. It's something which the teachers need to be taught about. And it's not a process or it's not a skill which is required only for the purpose of language learning by the students. As I discussed earlier also, language is an essential part, and language is the basic part of any subject. Whatever subject you are doing, you need to have a basic understanding of the language. So if the teacher is doing her part in that way, that the teacher is equipping the students with the skill of listening, she is doing half the job for the other subjects also. The listener needs to understand that there can be two styles of conversation. You can move from words to meanings, and you can move from meanings to words also. And it is all going to depend on different factors. What were those factors? Let's just recall about those four factors. It is going to depend on how familiar the listener is with what is being talked about, the depth of the information, the type of the information, and the listener's purpose of listening. I hope you all are clear with the understanding that how does the process of conversation goes. We have discussed that there are two ways in which we make sense of conversation. In one way, we are making the sense of conversation by focusing on the words used by the speaker, and in another way, we are making understanding of the conversation based on the previous knowledge we have about the same. So here the listener is focusing only on the keywords, wherein in the first process, the listener is focusing on the whole conversation which is happening, because the listener has to understand from the words which is being used by the speaker. Similarly, we also understood the first six stages of listening. What are the different six processes or six steps of the listening process? Once you have an understanding of the basic process of listening, the teacher is in a better position to help the students acquire the listening skill. That's all about this session. Hope you had a nice session.